The bandwidth for this episode of the AR-15 podcast is sponsored by the Firearms Radio Network. FirearmsRadio.tv.
Welcome to the AR-15 podcast. This is the podcast about your favorite black rifle. This show is for you. Whether you're building your first AR or you've been building ARs for years, there is something we can all do to take our black rifle to the next level.
You make this show possible by clicking through our Brownells and Amazon affiliate links. The next time you order online, go to AR15podcast.com and click through our Brownells and Amazon affiliate links. It doesn't cost you anything extra, and a small portion of your sale goes to supporting pro-gun radio like the AR-15 podcast. Support the Firearms Network as a whole by pledging your support at patreon.com/FRN.
Welcome to another episode of the AR-15 podcast. Tonight we're going to cover episode number 140, just a mere 16 episodes from our three-year anniversary. And on this episode, we're going to be talking about how to see in the dark. So before we go any further, JW, why don't you tell our lucky listeners about what has been going on over there at the Patriot Patch Company?
Well, Reed and gang have been developing a couple cool new patches. These are real nice PVC, kind of 3D cut patches. I know, Reed, you're real excited for that Huckleberry patch.
I am.
Do you know when they're shipping? Scene.
You know, I have not been able to get any details from the gnomes that, you know, mine the PVC and, you know, run the factory, but I'm hoping soon.
Okay. Well, yeah, if you head on over to patriotpatch.co, you can see what Ryan's been designing. There's definitely some cool swag from the rest of the Firearms Radio Network, some different logo stickers and patches in the works. So give them a look and see if you can add something to your range bag, to your tactical Velcro jacket or Arc'teryx hat, something like that. Find a good match for a Patriot patch.
Absolutely. And so JD is joining us tonight, and JD may very well be the salvation of the show, since we're going to hang all of our future success on his participation, and we'll just kind of see if he can live up to the expectation here. But
yeah, everybody's probably been hearing from him already, unbeknownst to them. He's been pulling some of the strings over on the Facebook page, helping us kind of engage with people, ask some questions on a regular basis. So if you have been going back and forth with him and responding to some of those, we really appreciate it. And this is the guy. Now you meet him. JD, well, welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks, guys. I'm glad to be here.
JD, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself? You know, I've spoken to you at length, but that doesn't mean that I've been able to convey that to anybody else.
I've been in radio broadcasting for 18 years, and I've been listening to the AR-15 podcast since the beginning, also Gun Guy Radio since Jake started. Love guns. They were really not a part of my life until about 5 years ago when a home invasion next door kind of made it necessary to have more than a baseball bat to walk out the front door with. And since then, when you buy one, you got to buy two more, and maybe three more, maybe five more. So other than that, I'm a foster dad. I've got five adopted kiddos, and man, guns and kids, those are the two things I collect. So,
well, I just want to let the listeners know that JD may be the first truly addicted gun guy on the AR-15 podcast.
It's pretty bad. You guys mentioned something, and I find myself buying it before the episode's over. So,
we'll make sure you use our affiliate links for that.
Absolutely.
So we've got a guest with us, and you know, I'm going to let Ryan introduce himself and tell us a little bit about who he is and what he does, so that we can segue into our topic tonight. Ryan, why don't you introduce yourself to the listeners here?
right. I'm Ryan Hoover. I'm the owner of Nightlong Industries. I started Nightlong Industries about 2 years ago. Kind of got started in the night vision realm by working on and flying with night vision devices in my time in the Army. Took over our maintenance program for all our aviation goggles, and that kind of led me down the road to, you know, messing around with them on my own for building my own stuff. And next thing I know, I'm kind of talking with some big wigs in the industry and decided to go into the business kind of building and maintaining and selling night vision equipment and kind of sharing my knowledge and some of the equipment I had with others to kind of show others what's out there and what's available.
Awesome. Well, awesome. There's going to be links and stuff in the show notes, but just quickly here at the top, could you tell people how to find Nightlong?
Yeah, our website is www.nightlongind.com. We're on Facebook, Nightlong Industries, LLC. You can follow us on Instagram as well. I'm always posting random stuff up on Instagram, Nightlong Industries. And all my contact information, email, and phone number are available on the website if anybody has any questions or wants to talk more about it after the show.
Awesome. Well, let's just hop right into this. What are we talking about with night vision? So there is, I guess, a couple different perspectives that people come into this from, whether it's video games, being able to just press a button and see in the dark, or whether it's what we see in movies. But it involves quite a bit of technology. I guess, Ryan, tell us a little bit about what is going on from converting dark into light. And I know there's a bunch of different ways to do that, but just kind of high level, what sort of technology are we talking about?
So the basics of pretty much every generation and type of night vision are they take ambient light and they amplify it and use what little light is available to produce an image. Most people that have seen it or familiar with it are used to seeing a green and black image that's produced by a green phosphorus screen and is made to produce an image, so you can use that to see in the dark, to make shots in the dark. There's people that use it for astronomy, all kinds of interesting, unique situations where you need to be able to see with very minimal amounts of light.
Now, it's my understanding that back in, like, Vietnam, there were scopes that weren't electronic in any way. It was just kind of a optical, or I don't know if there were any chemical plates or anything like that, but it was very low definition, but also fairly simple technology compared to what we have now.
Yeah, the early Starlight scopes were pretty primitive, just used very basic tubes. Were not very efficient. They took batteries that are pretty power hungry, and like you were saying, they don't really produce a very good image. And unless you have fairly decent lighting conditions, you know, a quarter moon and starlight, you wouldn't really be able to produce an image that would be usable as far as seeing stuff, and especially not identifying something and taking a shot on it. Obviously, since then, we've kind of set ourselves apart from the rest of the world and really, you know, embraced this technology and developed it better than any other country in the world. And, you know, we own the night now, as you frequently hear. You know, the nighttime is our time to fight because nobody else can do it as well as we can.
Awesome. You're talking about tubes. Explain that a little bit for us.
All right. One quick. So a tube, this is just a current Gen 3 MX11769 night vision tube. So this little device has all the phosphor screen and everything to produce the image from the input side on the optics objective side to the output screen that you're seeing through the eyepiece. This particular one goes for a PBS-14, so it has this little pigtail coming off of it, and that's what you use to control the gain. So on this particular one, you can actually physically turn the gain up and down, kind of adjust how bright the screen is and how good a resolution contrast you have by turning the little knob on the front of your PBS-14.
So that's going to go inside a housing with glass on either end that feeds optically feeds it in the front and focuses it, and then at the back turns it into something that your eye at a certain distance can see clearly.
Makes the image on the back, and you can adjust the most traditional night vision units these days have a diopter focus on them. You can adjust them. So I've got pretty close to 20/20 vision, so I can set it pretty close to zero, and it'll be in focus for me. Somebody has worse vision. Depends on how bad their vision is, but a lot of times they can actually focus and adjust the diopter enough that they can use night vision devices without having to use their eyeglasses in a lot of cases. So it gives them a little bit more freedom. This tube here is available and is used in most night vision devices currently on the market, from BVS-14s to clip-ons to the fusion systems that you see coupled with thermal. They all pretty much use this formatted tube now. So
So that's the heart of the system, and then you can kind of build different feature sets around it.
Right. This is probably about 70 to 80% of the cost of almost any unit you make, save for some of the clip-ons. Anything that's mounted to a weapon handling recoil usually has a little bit more added cost on the optics end for that, but this is most of what you're paying for.
Okay. Are there any other technologies kind of at play? I've seen some things like at gun shows and stuff that are like all digital, and they say, oh yeah, you can look at it during the daytime, and it's basically like it looks like a camcorder inside almost.
Sure. So probably one of the most common would be like the Pulsars, Armasite, ATN, both have their own kind of digital night vision that they call it, as they call it, and it essentially just is a camera lens. It usually has a pretty good low light resolution, and it's able to kind of use some of that same like IR invisible light that you use with night vision to produce an image. In my experience, usually the quality isn't as good. It has some, you know, pretty bad, especially with an extreme low light situations, it's very difficult to see. With that being said, I like taking pictures and kind of follow the other consumer electronics a lot. And some of the new cameras coming out on the market do phenomenal in extreme low light. So I kind of expect in probably the next 3 to 5 years you'll be seeing more units like that. They will perform better and be more capable as better camera options come available. I know like the new Sony A7S is a prosumer grade camera, and the night video and the night pictures you can take are just absolutely phenomenal. It just blows me away every time I see a video taken with one of them at night, because, you know, other than the coloring being a little off, you can hardly tell. So I think as you see more of that developed on the consumer side of the other side of the market, that will make its way into the tactical side, like you see happen with a lot of other equipment in this realm.
Yeah, that's exciting. Hey,
Ryan, is that the near-infrared spectrum of the consumer market? Don't they refer to it as a near-infrared capability? Yeah.
So that would be a lot of what that's using is like the 800 to 900 nanometer, which is really right on the spectrum of IR to near-IR.
Right.
A lot of the consumer-grade cameras on the photography side have coatings in them to prevent them from seeing IR light, because that can do a lot of goofy stuff with the images you take. But there's companies that also will modify those cameras to remove those coatings or eliminate that filter so you can take IR pictures, which is kind of a whole different style of photography, but you can definitely get a lot better low light and not necessarily no light, but extreme low light pictures out of stuff like that.
Right. And are they're less susceptible to the harm that can happen to those tubes in the traditional night vision, right?
Correct. So most of the tubes now, that tube I was just showing you, that's actually an auto-gated tube. So what that tube is designed to do is if it senses a bright light, it will basically cut the power, turn the power on and off to prevent an overwhelming light from damaging the tube. Now, that only works for so long. So if I were to, you know, turn my PDS-14 I have sitting on behind me now and leave it in the room with it on for the next 8 hours, I would most likely have a spot burn into it just because this is a bright, well-lit room, and that's what's going to happen. If I were to turn it on real quick, look around, and turn it off, there probably wouldn't be any damage done to that particular tube. When you talk some of the older stuff, the Gen 1, the Gen 2 equipment, it didn't have all those safety features built into it, and they were a lot more susceptible to damage very quickly. Some of the Gen 1 units, if you turn them on in daylight, you're pretty much done. They've come a long way since then, thankfully. They're a little bit more forgiving, because I'll readily admit I've accidentally left stuff on and threw it in my backpack after a night of hunting or something and come back, and I'm quite pleased that it's not damaged. So I, for one, greatly appreciate the checks and balances they put on this stuff for me.
Now, you're talking about infrared light. How does that come into play? Because it's not, I guess you can think of infrared coming off of heat sources sometimes, but otherwise, where do we encounter that? Is it something that we need to, like, add to the system, or are there certain things that we're looking out, looking around that are emitting IR?
There's a lot of stuff out there that emits at IR that people aren't aware of. Probably some of the most common things are like TV remote controls. I know on the iPhones, there's a little IR light that flashes on the front that basically just allows the phone to be able to tell how bright it is and adjust the screen brightness to that. So if you have your night vision and you set your iPhone out on the table, you'll see a little IR strobe going that otherwise you can't see. In the natural environment, there's just a lot of IR light in the sky from just the atmosphere. So if you're outside, and even if it's not a lot of moonlight, you'll still encounter a lot of IR light and still be able to see very well. Now, as you start getting cloud cover or other, you know, some places you have to consider smog, as that starts coming in, moisture in the air, that'll affect that IR light getting down. So it'll appear darker because you don't have as much IR light. Inside a house, you don't have the benefit of that. So if you were to go in a house that had all the shades drawn, all the lights off, there probably wouldn't be a lot of IR light unless there's electronic devices that are on in there that kind of produce it. If you were to go in a room that had no electronic devices, no windows, and the door was shut, it would be very, very dark, probably almost darker than anything you could simulate in the natural environment outside. And in an instance like that, that's when, even with the newest units, the Gen 3 units, you would want to turn on an IR flashlight or the IR lasers. The IR lasers don't do as much, but the flashlights would give you that light you need to help the night vision tubes to produce an image and be able to see what's around you.
Okay. So in more of a offensive sort of situation, you're kind of assuming that maybe you're the only one that's got night vision on, and so flooding the scene with infrared makes it so you can see, but it's basically invisible to anyone that's not wearing night vision.
Correct. So yeah, like in an active, if you're using it actively, you've got an IR laser you can aim with, you've got an IR light you can illuminate with. Some of these IR lights now you can see several hundred yards away pretty effectively. And with that additional IR light, your night vision units can be working at its peak performance and just really giving you the best image, best quality, and helping you discern what's out there. And, you know, friend or
someone
foe.
Carrying a cell phone or a handgun.
Exactly. And that's where it becomes really, really critical to, you know, make that proper observation. Whether it's, you know, against two-legged targets or four-legged targets. You know, there's a lot of guys. I'm a big coyote hunter around me. I'm in the Midwest. And, you know, there's people who are much more risk-averse than me that would make shots on otherwise questionable lighting conditions. And, you know, you don't know if it's a coyote or a deer necessarily. Like, it kind of looks like it's got a coyote, but being able to have that IR light, the state I live in, we can't use any IR light, so I don't get that benefit to play with. So we have to play it a little bit more cautiously, but some of the other states you can use IR light, and having that floodlight to turn on and say, yeah, that's a coyote, or that's the neighbor's dog, or that's a deer. You know, that could be a pretty critical call depending on what you're doing.
Yeah, that makes sense. When you start shopping for night vision, you see different generations. People say, oh, this is 1, 1+, 2, 3, sometimes 4. Some guys talk about Gen 4 stuff. What are they talking about? Is this different sorts of guts? Is this just finer and finer manufacturing of the same sort of thing? What are the big differences in those generations?
There's different manufacturing processes for each of the different generations. 2 and 3, I would say, are more similar to each other than any of the other versions. Gen 0, Gen 1 are kind of the, nowadays, what we would call the Russian night vision stuff. The ATN, the Armasite, you know, the stuff they sell in Sportsman's Guide, they sell in Cabela's, they sell in your local sporting goods store that you could buy for $100 to a couple hundred dollars. That stuff is kind of very dated technology, almost Vietnam era as far as how it's produced, the quality of it, and the picture you're going to get out of it.
Now, wait a minute. I've used one of those old Vietnam era night vision scopes, and it's nothing.
Yeah.
Nothing like the worst Gen 1 today. And you know, the device that I used, I mean, it had a collector that was probably as big as a, you know, a saucer. It was at least, you know, 8 inches across. And the thing weighed like 20 pounds, so it was like more than twice as heavy as the you know, M16 I was carrying.
Sure.
But
I bet it had night sights built in, too. Or not night sights, iron sights.
No, it didn't have iron sights. But, you know, imagine you've got the A2 carry handle, and that thing bolts on top of the A2 carry handle. I mean, there is just no satisfying way to use that thing. So I mean,
I would agree.
The Gen 1 stuff compared to that, it's leaps and bounds in terms of they've made it smaller, they've made it lighter.
Yes.
It's just not better in terms of what its capabilities are, because it's still the same technology, right?
Correct. Yeah. I mean, they've definitely made them in much smaller packages. This here is a little Armasite Spark. They're available for about $550, $580, and it's considered a Gen 1, but it actually produces a pretty decent image. If you have the ability to use it with IR light, to use it with IR lasers for whatever you're doing, you can get a pretty satisfactory image and have a pretty good idea what's going on in even pretty much the darkest of places. Now, if you're living in a state like Iowa where we can't use IR light, can't use IR lasers, and you want to go out coyote hunting, it's probably not going to be a very good option because it's only going to get you maybe a couple hours more shooting after it gets dark compared to some of the newer stuff that, you know, you could shoot all night if depending on what you're doing. So it really boils down to what your use of it is going to be and how willing you are to add the supporting equipment. The Gen 1 stuff, if you're willing to add a, you know, a quality IR light, a quality laser, which, quite frankly, you could buy for $150 a piece, you would be leaps and bounds ahead of someone who was using a flashlight or didn't have anything at all, for sure.
Yeah, kind of the gap that I see with the nicer, like the Gen 3 stuff that's a real quality tube, is you're getting a super clean image without blemishes. I guess there's no kind of noise that's like always on in the field of view, so you might have like some spots that are kind of annoying. And like you're saying, if you don't have the infrared, or if you're just kind of walking around out in the woods looking at the stars, something like that, it's picking up that much more detail without needing the IR.
Right.
So, I mean, it's so easy to get an infrared illuminator nowadays.
Right.
It's really making some of the lower cost alternatives usable.
Definitely. Probably one of my most used lights, I've got one on my helmet, I've got a couple rifles with them, are the little Enforce WMLs, and they put out good white light, they put out good IR light, they're like $150, they're, you know, really affordable, and they do pretty much everything. Pretty quality item in my opinion. And, you know, if you pair that with a little Gen 1 binocular, you could do do and see a lot more than you ever thought you would be able to once it gets dark out at night.
I guess let's go back. You mentioned you wore these suckers when you were flying. tell me about that and maybe the differences between the military equipment that's available to our soldiers versus what we can get our hands on the civilian market, and if there's like laws that separate those things. What are some of those considerations?
So, yeah, I've been in the Army 12 years now. Work on Chinooks, and for about the last 6 years I've been a flight engineer flying on them. So I actually go out and get to fly on them pretty much every day. We were deployed to Iraq in 2011, and while we were there, we were the only Chinooks in country, so we ended up picking up a lot of missions, flying a lot, and I ended up flying about...
The Marines don't fly Chinooks?
Nope.
Did they get rid of all their Chinooks?
They've got CH-46s, but they just, I think they just retired the last one in the past couple months, to be honest.
Damn.
It's all Ospreys and CH-53s now.
The Sea Stallions and Super Stallions. All right. Well, now I've just dated myself. Go ahead.
So, yeah, we were flying almost all our missions at night, so about 95% of the time we flew over there was wearing goggles. So we were wearing Anvis 6s, which is the Army's aviation goggle. I flew around 550 hours of combat hours with MVGs and kind of really got a really good appreciation for the difference between a quality, well-maintained set of goggles and, this meets the margins but not quite set of goggles. So after we got back from that, I was really pushing to, I kind of want to take over this program because I want to make some changes. I want to make them better. And that's kind of when I got started real hard into the night vision realm as far as the repair and upgrades and maintaining them. It was after we returned from Iraq.
And so you had a system that had a tube dedicated to each eye. Was it different in any other ways? I see some guys listing, hey, these are aviation ones, these are up-armored ones, kind of what the preferred units are for guys that are flying around.
Sure. For us, we used Anvis 6s, auto-gated tubes. They were like Omni 6, Omni 7 specs, so pretty much the latest spec as far as Gen 3 goes. So we were using the best of the best that was available then and honestly still is available now. The housing was very lightweight. As far as a bino unit goes, we had one tube per eye, but durability-wise, maybe wasn't very durable. We broke a couple. I see them breaking, usually kind of like hairline fractures will start breaking. Usually I catch it before they completely break and replace the stuff I need to, but they do break. A lot of the ground guys while we were over there, especially like the special forces groups, had gotten Anvis aviation goggles from whereabouts unknown, but they had them. And so they were using them running around at night, and they broke a lot of them. And I think that's where you see a lot of the PVS-15 program, the PVS-31 program, there's the BNVDs, the Sentinels that are coming available now, was kind of filling that niche market for, those guys whose units are willing to pay the price to get them dual tube night vision and, the best of the best. There wasn't a good binocular available for ground use. You could make do, they offer the upgraded aviation goggles like you spoke of earlier. In my opinion, they're kind of a, an interim solution, especially by the time you send it off and you install the upgrade, you're halfway or more to actually getting a standalone bino unit that has a ability to take a dovetail mount, has IR built in, just a lot more durable unit as a whole. So
let me ask you a question, Ryan, before you go. You're talking about this in terms of what they're using that they borrowed from your side of the theater. What is it that they were originally issued that they stopped using?
Most of the traditional military, even to this day, started out with the PVS-7, which would be this little guy here. So This would be like the first of the Gen 3s. It's got two little eyepieces. It's got one tube, one objective lens. A lot of people kind of started getting these in the 80s, big through the 90s, initial push into Iraq. They were still using them. I think we still had them in our unit until like a year ago, to be honest. I don't know what they used them for. I never saw anybody use them, but we had them. Pretty common. And then the next step from there was getting the PVS-14s. So this is probably what most people, as far as night vision go, are familiar with. The PVS-14 is kind of the night vision device because every infantryman, every Army soldier, everybody's, for the most part, used one of these. Every Marine that's currently serving or has served. Traditional one eyepiece, one objective lens, one tube, mounts to your helmet over your left or right eye. Additionally, have the weapon mounts to mount it behind on an M4, on an M16, whatever you might choose to mount it onto. Most of those guys were using these. So the downsides are, if you've got a monocular, you've got one eyepiece, one objective, and your other eye is just seeing what's around you. Some people like that, some people don't. For the guys that are, moving very quickly, doing raids, operating in really confined spaces, kind of more the CQB mount type operations, most of them like a set of binoculars because it gives you better peripheral division because you have two tubes, they're spread out a little bit more. You get a little bit more depth perception with, if you're trying to go up a set of stairs, trying to go through doorways, it's really helpful to have good depth perception. And I think that's kind of where they started getting the AMVIS units, because I was really about the only bino unit available for Gen 3 night vision.
And so these guys were getting rides, and they saw the pilots wearing these dual setups, and they were like, hey, where can I get a hold of those?
Let's procure a bunch of those. I don't know where they got them from, but they had a lot of them.
Yeah.
They break them and go get a new pair.
Procurement and fear has got to be one of their chief skill sets, isn't it?
Well, they are very good at it. I can attest to that, yeah.
I did my first run through a shoot house just a couple weeks ago with a dual pair, used to running just a single 14, and definitely see advantages, disadvantages going both ways. Yeah. It'd be nice to have a pair of both, I guess.
Right.
But there's definitely some pluses and minuses on both sides.
Yeah, there's a very different plus and minuses for them. Obviously, the binos way more because there's more to them. PVS-14 is, or any other monocular for that matter, is much lighter because it's only one tube. Mounts are generally smaller. Some people really like having one dark adapted eye in case they need to transition quickly. They can go right to it. I know like a lot of law enforcement like that because they can turn on their white light and use their non-night vision eye to make a shot or look down the rifle. Some of the benefits to the bino, we kind of already went over the depth perception, the little bit wider peripheral view.
Yeah, and just running through the house with the duals on, with a laser, I mean, it felt like I was unstoppable, whereas the 14 is more like, I'll maybe take a look over there, take a look over there. It was just so much more natural to kind of flow through the house with the duals on.
Yeah, it definitely is, especially in a small area like that, it's a lot more comfortable for me to use binos because I just feel like I know what's going around me. Even if I can't necessarily see it, I can catch glimpses out of each side a lot better than with using just a monocular.
Mm-hmm. Cool. I know we've kind of touched on some of the specific military designations for them. I guess let's widen the horizon and talk about, we've discussed some of the things that you can put on your head, on a helmet, something like that. What are some of the options that you can put straight on your gun, whether you're looking for just something to observe everything with, or whether it's more of a long-range setup? What are kind of the options that are available there?
Probably one of the cheapest, most flexible options is just taking your traditional PVS-14. So we've just got a PVS-14 here, and then this one's got a AV night vision mount on it up front, clamped around the ring that for the objective lens. And then on your rifle, you just got this small little dovetail mount plate right here. So if you want to use it, all you do is slide the dovetail in, locks in place. On this rifle, I got an EXPS 3-0 mounted to it. So you turn your reticle on, put it in night vision mode, turn on your PVS-14. As long as your reticle's zeroed, wherever you line it up and pull the trigger, that's where you're going to get a hit. Same works for observing. Downside to that is if you're observing, you got to point your rifle at whatever you're looking at. So if it's kind of in an environment where you're not necessarily going to be making a shot or don't necessarily want to point your rifle at whatever you're looking at, that is something to keep in consideration. It's a lot easier to do it handheld. But the benefit to this is you just push the button, pull it out, and you can use it handheld. And if you're ready to make a shot or want to make a shot, slide it in the dovetail. It's ready to go. So,
hey, Ryan. It's not like you got to worry about a return to zero or anything like that because
right.
Behind the optic and the optic isn't changing.
No, if
hey,
you're
Ryan,
ready to do it,
on a setup like that, when you have magnified optics, is it the same thought process in terms of putting the night vision in the loop, or is there a different mechanism or even a different device that's required to, say, take your night force scope and turn it into a night vision capable
sure.
optic?
So with like a PVS-14, something like this, you can mount it to like the back end of a scope. There's a couple different, there's like the monolock, there's a couple of different adapters you can purchase. Some people even make their own that basically mate the objective lens of the PVS-14 to the back of your scope. And it works pretty well compared to what other, to mounting it in front. So the thing to consider kind of that you were alluding to, if you mount it behind, whether it's magnified or not magnified, as long as this is zeroed, you're going to get the same image on the backside. If you put the crosshairs over it, pull the trigger, and that's where it's going to hit as long as you're zeroed. If you take this PVS-14 and you move it to the front, it's now looking through this device. So to look through another device, it needs to be perfectly collimated. Basically, the dead center of the objective lens needs to match the dead center of the eyepiece. If that doesn't happen, you'll get some sort of zero shift.
Right.
In my experience, like with a PVS-14, because I get asked it quite a bit, I'll throw them on and go shoot them. I've had as little as 6 inches at 100 yards, and I've had as much as 8 feet at 100 yards. So as far as making shots, it's not what I would consider repeatable nor acceptable. So with this type of unit, mounting it behind is definitely the way to go.
So here's, I guess, the next observation. So obviously, if you're operating with the PVS-14 with your EOTech, you're talking about things that, relatively speaking, are in close proximity. And so
sure.
Your ability of the PVS-14 to work, to pick up the light, to provide you the image you want, is based on the immediate environment. Now, if I've got that, piggybacked on a night force, and I'm looking, 600 yards downrange, am I going to be able to pick up the distinguishing features through the night vision optic that are at 600 yards, or is the infrared spectrum have problems traveling that distance to deliver the image I need to see?
With the PVS-14, you most likely wouldn't, and a lot of that is to do with the size of the lens. As with like traditional day scopes, the bigger your objective is, generally speaking, everything else can being the same, you're going to get more light through. You're going to be able to see better in lower light conditions. Same thing happens with night vision. So with PVS-14, it has a very small objective to keep waste down, to keep costs down. Doesn't suck in as much light as, say, a PVS-27 clip-on that's got a huge, like, 6-inch soup can on it on the front of it. That will pull in a lot more light and give you a lot better resolution and clarity in low light conditions with more magnification. Depending on how you set it up, you can use it pretty well. I've actually mounted a PVS-14 to my Vortex Optics spotter, and we were shooting 1,000 yards, and you could see through the spotter the reticle, the steel we were shooting at, and everything. That spotter does incredibly well in low light, so it was pulling a lot more light than a traditional scope would, or even a less expensive spotter. So that kind of gave the PVS-14 an added advantage. But generally speaking, you wouldn't be able to use it very effectively, no.
Okay.
So when you step to more of a magnified situation, you're talking about clip-ons, something that goes to the front. Is that a device? I'm sure you're going to reach down and grab one, aren't you? Is that a device that has magnification built in, or what's going on kind of optically in it?
No, they do not have magnification, generally speaking. Pretty much all the clip-ons are 1x or unity magnification. So whatever the input is on the front is what it's going to output on the rear side. And then whatever your optics doing is what you'll see. So this is an Adams Industry Legionnaire. This is kind of my baby. I kind of worked with Chris Adams of Adams Industry to bring this clip-on to market. It's a Gen 3 unit, this particular one, but just clips on in front, it's guaranteed less than half MOA, point aim, point of impact at 100 yards.
Oh, wow.
I've actually shot this one, and it was closer to a third with this particular one. So,
is it something that you zero to get it that way, or it's just lining everything up and it's good to go?
With the clip-on devices, they're built properly. They should come and be able to guarantee half an MOA or less. Pretty much all the big makers do. I know some of the manufacturers have had issues not being able to maintain that, not being repeatable. This particular unit, my L3 units that I have, I've never had an issue with. They've worked great. All have been half MOA or less, basically to the point where I put it on and I shoot it because it's not worth messing with my zero to take that point one out or quarter MOA. So
what we're looking at here for those that are listening, the objective lens is gigantic compared to the PVS-14. It's almost like a big, huge 1,000 lumen flashlight looking thing on the front of your gun there. And then you've got like a 1:6 power just sitting right behind it.
Right. Yeah, so this is the Vortex Razor 2 1:6 behind it. But just looks through it. If I go to one power on my scope, I'll see the 1x reticle. I'll be able to see whatever the image is in the front. The downside with the 1x scopes like this, you got to go about 1.25. If you go to 1, you'll actually see the edges of the tube because the field of view on the clip-on are narrower than the scope with this particular model scope. Mm-hmm. Pretty much any other scope that's more than one power, you know, 1.5, 2.5, you would never notice that. But with most of the 1:4s and 1:6s, you do to a degree.
Hey, Ryan, so you mentioned the whole issue of collimation.
Yes.
Is that something that is a part of this setup that has to be a consideration?
Yes. So the collimation of the clip-on should be done by whoever the manufacturer is. If that is done correctly, that's really all you need to worry about. So you might notice here, this is kind of my ongoing experiment. I've got the scope, and obviously the center of bore axis on the scope is significantly lower than the clip-on device.
Right.
That's kind of one of the big things that people in the industry try to push: night vision height rings, night vision height scope mounts. There's a lot of night vision height products built to use with clip-on units. I shot this particular rifle and this particular clip-on setup with that nice big nasty gap at 1,000 yards, and my point aim, point impact difference between day and night shooting was roughly half an MOA. So the downside to that and consideration is as you get further away from the center of the tube, so as you get further down like we see here, you're getting near the edge, which is generally a little bit lower resolution, passes less light. The actual optics are starting to curve, so you get a little bit more optical aberrations there. That being said, it's still perfectly usable. I mean, we shot it at 1,000 yards and it didn't change anything. So right. there is a degree of truth to using, you know, night vision height rings to get them perfectly aligned. But if you do have a gap, I mean, that's almost 3/8 of an inch there. But if you have a 1/4 inch or 1/8 inch gap, it's nothing to fret about either. I wouldn't go changing my complete weapon setup just to get different scope mount.
And so the design of the clip-on for that purpose is what differentiates it from being able to use the PVS-14 in the same role.
Correct.
Okay.
So they actually adjust the optics internally on the unit to make sure they're perfectly parallel all the way through. And kind of one of the ironic things is people think, you know, hey, this thing really pulls in a lot of light. It's bigger. It's perfect. You know, the optics are much better than a PVS-14. This thing should be awesome for using handheld, but the way the optics are built for using with the scope, it's almost impossible to use handheld. I mean, you can't really get a usable image of it, out of it at all, unfortunately. Okay. If you were able to, it would be phenomenal, though.
Okay, so this is a setup that you're really dedicating to something that already has a scope on it, and it's called a clip-on, so you can run your gun during the daytime and clip it off.
Correct.
But it's not something that you're gonna like pop off your helmet and stick onto the front of your gun.
Right. This is the one-trick pony of the night vision world. It does one thing very well, and that's about all she does. So.
Now, how about the dedicated scopes?
So the dedicated scopes, I have 2 and they're out on demo right now. So
oh, come on, man.
I'm sorry. I'm really slacking off. The probably the most common, most well-known would be like the PVS-4. That was kind of a late Vietnam War to the 80s military scope. Pretty large, mounted to the top of a rifle. Had interchangeable reticles. You could put it on an M16, or you could put it on a recoilless rifle. Had all kinds of crazy options with it.
I think that's what we used.
They actually stayed very current. They continued upgrading them, so they kind of started out as like the early Gen 2, and then by the end they were actually putting Gen 3 tubes in them. And I've messed with some of the Gen 3 tubes, and as you might be familiar with, Reed, they're very large optics, much bigger than even this clip-on here. With one of those with a Gen 3 tube, can really suck some light in. You can really see a lot of stuff. Downside to that, as Reed kind of alluded to earlier, they're very tall. So there's no getting a cheek weld. It's a chin weld, maybe a chin weld in the foam pad kind of optic. So they're a little bit more unique as far as how you use them, how you operate them. They do a very good job. Most of them they're around 3.5 to 4 power, so they're kind of a lower power optic. But at that range, they can really see a lot of light, and are pretty inexpensive, all things considered, compared to some of the night vision options that are out there.
Okay, so if you're getting into a night vision scope, you're probably going to pick a magnification. It's not like you're going to get a 1-6 power NV scope or a 3-9 NV. It's more of like a, hey, I want a 4 power, I want a 6 power.
I think, I know Armistead did, and I believe ATN kind of has made some models that had some variable power to them, but I haven't heard too much success with them. I haven't heard of too many people using them. So right now, most of them are like a dedicated. The other kind of more popular models are like the Raptor 4X, the Raptor 6X. They're kind of like the clip-on. They're kind of a one-trick pony. You mount them to a weapon.
It's almost a little more limiting, though, because
it is.
You gotta be shooting it at night.
Right. You gotta shoot it at night. You have to zero it at night. With some of them, you can put the cap on the front and actually zero them during the day. But ideally, you would be zeroing them at night. So, in a sense, it is a little bit more limiting. With the clip-on, as long as you know that the collimation's good on it, which is really a one-time shoot check with any good manufacturer, it should be a non-issue. Now I know if I take that clip-on off, I can stick it on any one of my rifles that's zeroed. and I'll be able to make hits at whatever ranges I want to make hits at, as long as I have a good dope on my ammo. So as far as ease of use, the clip-ons, I think, definitely get the nod in that respect.
Nice. I guess let's talk about some of the support equipment. We've been talking about running these things on your head. We've already talked about some of the mounts for Picatinny, where you can clip it right in.
Sure.
Or use a magnifier mount that you already have on your gun. How are people wearing these on their heads?
Probably the most common for like the Gen 3 units, especially the Bino stuff. Got my little helmet set up here. Throw that on. So this is my little tri-airframe I use for when we're doing shooting. I've got a Wilcox L4 G24 on this. It's probably one of the more common, though pricey and high-end helmet mounts out there. A lot of guys are using these with their Bino units. So I'll grab one of my Binos here. Got a little Sentinel here. Just clips in, locks right into place. So it's nice and easy. Push a button, flip it up out of the way. You want it, push a button, flip it down.
Pretty, I think I see what you're talking about.
So
now, for the sake of our listeners, JW and Ryan have donned their helmets, have clipped in their NVGs, and are having a conversation like, you know, two nocturnal creatures, you know. It's really rather hysterical, but it's a little hard to watch their conversation in all seriousness.
It's not that bad, is it?
No.
At least I don't have like a strobing light or something. I can get,
we can get that going if we want. But,
I can do like some blue light there. There you go.
So some of the more, probably the most common mount out there would be like the Neurotus Rhino. So that's like anybody who's bought a PVS-14 kit from almost anywhere. It comes with the Rhino mount. It comes with the J-arm. Very common, pretty straightforward, fairly inexpensive as far as mounts go. Downsides to that a lot of people don't like, or it's kind of cheaper. It's more plasticky than, say, like the Wilcoxes that are all aluminum and yeah. You know, very well built, very high precision,
a lot of adjustability points,
right? Whereas the Rhino is kind of more of a one size fits all, and you make it work for whatever you're going to do. The J arms all plastic, most of them wobble around in almost any Rhino mount out there, so
you start running around and the optic itself is kind of bouncing on you.
Yeah, you usually start it with over your left eye, and then by the time you get to where you're going, it's somewhere over your nose, and you're chasing around trying to figure out where it went. So, but even like the cheaper options, like the Armorsight Sparkdown. I don't even know where I put that thing. The Armorsight Spark even has its own standalone helmet mounts that'll, you know, bolt right to most helmets. So you're talking a $500 Gen 1 unit. Helmet mounts, I believe, like another $75. So, I mean, you can
really screw a helmet mount onto anything if you've got a bike helmet, really.
Exactly. I mean, the first bump helmet started out as Pro-Tech skateboard helmets. And, you know, since then, OpsCore and Team Wendy and Cry have all kind of made it their own and improved the market, thankfully. But you can make anything into a helmet. I've got a little pink Pro-Tech that my daughter wears around that's got a helmet, MVG mount on it. So.
Nice.
She's my little...
Now, I would caution the listening audience not to use much more than an inch and a half, two-inch screw. You really begin to make some indentations into the forehead. So.
Yeah, it's... it's an expensive hospital visit, but, you know, I learned my lesson and I cut them down, so...
Now, how about other support equipment? We're talking about infrared. There's flashlights. There's lasers. I know there's some kind of civilian versus military considerations there. With the night vision, it seems like pretty much any level is available to the civilians. Whereas when you get into lasers, there's some limitations. Where do those come from?
So the IR lasers, and the IR lasers specifically, are actually regulated by the FDA. And okay. If you ask me why, I have no idea, but that's who the regulations go through. So their stipulation is for you or myself or Reed, you know, any one of us wants to go out and buy an IR laser, it has to be a Class 1 IR laser. So for Class 1, that means they're limited to 0.7 milliwatts output power. In comparison, if you're familiar with the military lasers, PEC-2s, the PEC-15s, the ISLIDs, those are anywhere from 15 up to several hundred milliwatt. So you're talking powers of 10, greater power. The difference you'll see is in really high light environments, especially like an urban environment, where a PEC-15 on high power, you'll be able to see the dot against a building that's got lights on, that's lit up on the outside. If you turn on your civilian 0.7 milliwatt laser, you know, you might not be able to pick it up. On the flip side of that, if it's dark out, you're not in an urban environment, out in a field, generally speaking, I can't tell a huge difference. And in some cases, especially like indoors, in an urban environment, if you're indoors with little to no light, as we were speaking about earlier, it's just taking in a little bit of IR light there is out there. So if you turn on a 0.7 milliwatt laser, it'll be look like a nice round dot. If you turn on a PEC-15 on high, you'll get a lot of blooming, and it'll look like a big, you know, giant spot on the wall that's got a really
overblowing
shape
because your optic.
Right. So there's pluses and minuses to them. I mean, ideally, it would be awesome to have military lasers for everyone that, you know, you could pick any power you wanted to and run it at it and just tune it for the environment. But
now, is that like a safety issue? What's the concern with having high power lasers at Walmart?
The concern is
control of eyeballs.
Exactly. So a red or green laser, if you get one of those shining in your eye, your eye will automatically blink and want to prevent you from looking at it. The human eye doesn't react to IR light, however. So if somebody shines a 40 milliwatt IR laser in your eye from 10 feet away, you won't know that it's on until you get a nice permanent spot burned into your retina. So there are safety concerns with it. You know, there's a lot of precautions that go into the military using some of their higher power lasers in certain environments. But, you know, I guess the FDA decided that risk wasn't worth the reward, in their opinion, of civilians being able to have the same equipment for the do-it-yourself LASIK guys out there. So.
Well, and that's a bureaucratic full of sportness, if you ask me. Hey, Ryan, I've got a question to kind of piggyback off of that. So, sure. In terms of the night vision available for civilian purchase, would you say that they're, in most respects, identical to what is available to the military? Is there anything that's off limits to the consumer? And I mean, aside from export restrictions,
sure.
Can I go out and buy in my local supply house?
Can Reed set himself up like a Navy SEAL?
No. I don't think they have fat, old Navy SEALs. Well, maybe some retired ones, but you know, not the active duty guys.
As far as night vision goes, is like tubes, equipment, almost all of that is available to the civilian, except for a couple very unique items. The GPMVG, the quad eye that everybody remembers from, you know, some of the more recent Navy SEAL movies, although rumored to be available to sale for civilians, I've never seen one actually shipped to civilians. If you're willing to cough up the $38,000 to $60,000 it's going to cost you. So there's particular items like that are more restricted on the type of unit it is rather than the technology it has inside of it. The PBS-15s, the PBS-31s are less common on the civilian market, and most of those get through kind of a law enforcement agency if they do come up on the market. But as far as the tubes and the performance, if you're willing to pay the price, you can get a tube as good or, honestly, in a lot of cases, better than what the military is getting, as long as you're willing to pay the price.
Hmm. It's not like they get x-ray vision goggles or something that we could never... Well, maybe they got some sort of Skunk Works lab that we haven't seen yet.
Maybe there's stuff I can't tell you about. I don't know.
I guess we mentioned the lasers. I've got one here. It just mounts on a Picatinny, and it's got like infrared, invisible. You can kind of choose. The process for using that is actually pretty cool, because once you start using the dot of the laser to, like, as a sighting system, you're not looking through the optic. It's not like you have to find your red dot and a laser and line it up and all that. You can actually shoot from the hip, right? I mean,
you
don't need that full cheek weld. You just put the dot on the target and squeeze off the round.
Nice.
Yeah, I know when I'm shooting some of my carbines with the lasers, especially kind of closer range, faster environments, when I'm shooting, I generally just, you know, I'll go from putting it up on my shoulder and just drop it down, you know, right in the bottom of my armpit kind of, and so I'm still pulling it up like I traditionally would as far as for doing reloads, for clearing misfire, whatever it may be, but I can get that down and out of the way so those optics aren't blocking my vision with my night vision. So I've got a full picture, unlike in a lot of cases what you're seeing, you know, during the day. I mean, even with the aim points and the EOTechs, you kind of get that little bit of a tunnel vision as you're looking through it, even if you're shooting both eyes open, because you're kind of focusing on what's going on inside the actual reticle, what's going inside the tube of the optic you're using. With the IR laser, it's like you're looking at, you know, your whole 40-degree field of view, and there's a little dot that's moving around, and you can manipulate it. So it can be a lot quicker. One of the things we practice when we're flying in the Army is we go out and we'll do door gunnery, and almost without fail, our door gunnery during the day doesn't go as well and isn't as accurate as our door gunnery at night, because at night we've got our PEC-15s on, and all we got to do is put the little red dot on whatever we want to hit, and it doesn't matter how fast we're going or which direction we're going, we can walk the bullets in from wherever it may hit, because it's going to be within a couple feet. Whereas when you're shooting during the day, you're trying to get a good sight picture, which is kind of difficult to do because you're flying and things are moving around. Whereas when you're shooting at night, you just stand behind it and just move the dot around. So it can be a very quick sighting system, depending on what you're doing.
Nice. What are some of the other options for seeing in the dark? We've kind of talked about this whole intensifying either natural light or infrared light. Things like thermal scopes.
Sure.
Tell me a little bit about some of those other options, because I've seen actually where they merge them together.
Yeah.
And there's also dedicated thermal things. Tell me a little bit about that world.
So the thermal, I think, has probably come the furthest most recently. It was really starting to become popular probably about 15 years ago. And honestly, since the war on terror kind of kicked off, there's been a lot of money dumped into developing better and smaller and more efficient thermal devices, which we're now kind of reaping the benefits of now in the civilian market. The thermal use a little bit different process, so they're actually seeing heat, which means, you know, if you get a thermal unit and you could go outside at noon, turn it on and see stuff, you go outside at midnight and see stuff. It's a little bit more flexible in that regard. Now, that being said, since it's seeing heat, it does have some limitations. As the day goes on and stuff gets more heat-soaked, especially if you're kind of in a more urban or rural environment where there's not a lot of different things that absorb heat and release heat differently, you just got a lot of dirt and trees and foliage around, you won't be able to see as much contrast between them because everything's the same temperature. It's all been absorbing sunlight for hours and hours on end. Unless there's something that's really, really warm or really, really cold, it can kind of tend to blend together. And you'll see that happen in a lot of different stuff with the thermal. A lot of people like to think of, you know, especially like the hunters, you know, am I going to get night vision or am I going to get thermal? And I guess myself, I see them more as complementary technologies. You know, I can take a thermal scope and go out coyote hunting, and I can pick up coyotes I might not have seen with the night vision and say, hey, there's one running up that creek bed, or there's one over in that tree line. Then I can switch to my night vision, positively identify it as, yeah, that is a coyote, that's not a deer, that's not a, you know, whatever, that white blob is a coyote, and then make my shot once I've seen it. Whereas a lot of people like to think, well, should I get this really expensive night vision, or should I get this really expensive thermal? It definitely has a lot of benefits that night vision doesn't. You know, being able to pick up heat, using it during the day, you can do a lot of stuff. I use one of my thermal units to go around and check my attic to see if I needed to add more insulation up there. So, you know, it like paid for itself pretty much, I think.
Yeah, that's one of the things you can tell the wife.
Yeah. Don't tell her you have to amortize it over 30 years, though.
Well, you know, it's...
It's a lot of insulation.
It's relative, so... And so that's probably the most common. Some of the digital stuff out there is kind of borderline between night vision and what I would consider just like a camera technology. And we kind of already went over the pluses and minuses to that. I think that's another one of those that we're going to see a lot more out of, especially in the near future, just with some of the capabilities that are out there on the consumer camera market as they start carrying over are going to be probably really setting a new trend as far as in the night vision, low light realm.
Yeah, you see, like, I shoot DSLRs all the time, and it's like, ooh, it used to be like 800, 1600 ISO was like really pushing it and really noisy images. Now it's like 100,000, 200,000 ISO. It's just like these ridiculous numbers they're trying to compensate for because these sensors are just so sensitive.
Yeah, I think the Sony A7S can go up to like 406,000 ISO or something. Yeah. And I mean, it's just absolutely phenomenal what it can do.
Now, I've got a buddy that told me about some that he used in training that puts a thermal image on top of a night vision image. That sounded expensive to me.
It costs a few dollars. So there's three common military ones, at least that I'm aware of. There's probably more that I'm not aware of. There's a Cody, a clip-on thermal imager, that actually you just physically slide right over the end. I mean, you could put it on a PBS-7, honestly. It would slide over the end of your objective, and it's got a little sensor that would hang down below it and would project a thermal image into your night vision device. And your tube picks it up. So inside your image intensifier, you'll see a regular night vision image, and then you can set it for different modes. You can set it for, like, if something's really significantly warmer than the environment around it, it'll show up as a big blob. Or sometimes, probably the coolest one I've seen is it'll make it an outline. So, like, if there's a person, you'll see kind of a dark, shady figure through the night vision, and then there's a thermal outline around them, like, oh, yeah, that's a human figure, obviously. The other two are the PSQ-36 and the PSQ-20. So the PSQ-20 is a monocular, PSQ-36 is a set of binoculars, and those actually have a thermal imager built into it, and on the screen projection itself, it overlays that thermal image. And you can actually kind of tweak each one. So if you want to have brighter night vision and lower thermal, you can do that, or vice versa. Those ones that I have, like, you can do the thermal in color. So, like, everything you're seeing, it'll be green, and anything that's warm will show up as a yellow or a red or something that's distinctly different than the green you're seeing through the night vision.
Wow.
Price point for those, like the Cody, so just the clip-on Cody, not including a night vision device, I believe is around $65,000 to $7,000. PSQ-20, PSQ-36, I've rarely ever seen for sale. The 20s were usually in the $12,000 plus, and I think the only set of 36 that I ever saw for sale was somewhere in the 20s. So, well outside the realm of possibility for almost everybody I know, at least. So,
yeah.
Very cool technology, but it's definitely one of those things that's kind of an emerging technology, and I'm sure we'll see more developed with that, and maybe more of a consumer version that's...
Yeah, I've got one of those little clear sensors for my iPhone, and just the amount that they've developed in that over the last couple years, I can imagine they're going to be just dropping the prices like crazy on of the higher-end systems.
Let me ask you a question. On that combination setup, does it have the quality in terms of night vision that you're going to see in the latest and greatest of pure night vision with an overlay of the thermal technology? Or is it, in having to combine the two, you've compromised something on both realms, and so it's not quite as good as the pure FLIR or the pure night vision? Is it a middle ground, or is it...
In my experience, they're actually very... I don't feel that there was anything compromised.
Okay.
With like the PSQ-20 and the PSQ-36, you can actually turn off one or the other mode. So if you want to run pure night vision, you can just turn on the night vision and use it that way, which is... they're using, you know, the latest Gen 3 auto-gated tube, kind of the best of the best. So if you run it that way, you wouldn't really notice a difference from your PBS-14 or your Bino unit. But then you've got that extra capability. You can turn one more switch, and then you've got thermal overlay. So they're, I don't think they really sacrificed anything, which is probably why they are the price point they are.
Right.
If you were willing to kind of compromise the quality of the thermal image, willing to compromise the quality of the night vision, you could probably, you know, mash up something that would maybe be $5,000 or $6,000, but you wouldn't have the capabilities of a standalone unit of either type.
Sure.
So I think that's probably coming. That'll probably come to the consumer market at some point, something that's maybe a little less expensive, a little less quality, but you got the best of both worlds, and you know, somebody can actually afford to buy it other than our taxpayers.
I've seen some advertising for color night vision. Is there anything like that kind of coming down the pipe that you've been interested in?
Yeah, so I actually have number one of the color night vision project I've been working with Adams Industries on. And that's actually a little bit of a misnomer, but basically what it's doing is you're getting a red and a green image, and you're only missing the blues to have a full color. And what this kind of gives you is the red and green both kind of highlight different features of the environment. So as you see both of them, in this case, you have to use it with a Bino unit. So one eye sees red, one eye sees green. Your brain's pretty good at combining images of whatever it's seeing, mashes them together, and you kind of get this yellow, red, green overlay that's mashed up of all of them. So as you get that, you kind of get a lot more contrast between. I take it out and play with it all the time now because it's kind of been fun to mess around with, see what I can and can't see. But like before, I'd go out in my backyard and it's like, I have a chain link fence there. I know there's a chain link fence there. There's obviously a fence because there's black shapes there. Well, with the color night vision, since they're seeing kind of different spectrums of light and working a little differently, with that chain link fence, I can see, you know, each of the individual links and where they're at, and I can see which ones have light reflected on them and which ones don't, which ones are in the shade of the tree, you know, even in the middle of the night, and which ones are, you know, maybe catching a street light or catching the moonlight off of it. And I go and walk through the fields around the house here, and like different plants have different types of light they release at different amounts. So like I can look out in a pasture, and instead of seeing a bunch of wavy grass, I can see there's grass, and then there's a ragweed, and there's a thistle over there, and they're distinctly different because the light looks differently through them. So that's something we're kind of perfecting on. Hopefully by SHOT Show we'll have some pretty cool stuff to show off for that. But I've got a video I've kind of been working together to kind of demonstrate what it does, what it looks like. It's kind of proprietary how exactly it works, so I can't really go into a lot of detail about that. But I'll be putting some videos on YouTube, hopefully pretty soon, kind of looking at what each individual tube looks like and then what they look like mashed up together. And it's pretty cool to see. It definitely gives you a little bit different aspect, makes you see just what's going on at night a whole lot differently, just because they see such different spectrums. It's pretty cool to see.
That's really interesting. I guess we've talked about a whole bunch of different kinds of night vision, of support equipment, goggles, scopes. This is the first question that Reed brought up when we were discussing this. How do you get them, and how much are you looking at spending? So I guess there's some different options as far as piecing these things together from different parts versus having somebody do that versus just buying something right out of the box. Could you kind of walk us through that? Because I know you do a lot of the kind of maintenance and builds yourself.
So probably the most least expensive for people that are willing to shop around, and this mainly would pertain to Gen 3 units. Gen 2, Gen 1, for the most part, are so inexpensive to buy complete that there's really no benefit to building one. The Gen 3, you can kind of see a little bit of a cost difference depending on what you do. So what a lot of people will do as far as building a Gen 3 unit is they generally go with a monocular, so a PVS-14 housing. There's a variety of other commercial housings available. Adams Industries, Pitbulls, and AB Night Vision makes a little NVM2 units like that. So they'll buy the housing. So say you buy a Pitbull for $300, and then you got to buy the eyepieces. So you can go on eBay, and there's sellers that sell PVS-14 eyepieces or Anvis eyepieces. They're both interchangeable with each other. If you get a used one, you might be able to pick one up for $80. New, they're usually over $150, $175, $180. Then you got to get an objective lens, which, depending on what kind you want, there's commercial glass out there. There's the mil-spec. So the mil-spec is generally, everything I use has mil-spec glass. It's, meets the specs. It has the filter coatings on it. It's actual glass. If you're looking to cut some corners on cost, there's, the commercial grade out there that's maybe doesn't have some of the filter coatings or isn't as high quality a lens. There's even some out there that are plastic lenses, which, for the most part, they work, but they won't transmit as much light through. So you can buy those for anywhere from, maybe $80 to $200, depending on what you're looking to get. So getting your housing together, you're looking at maybe $600 to $700 for, depending on what you're doing, to have a housing. And at that point, you just need a tube. There's all kinds of different tubes out there. There's everything from Gen 2 Photonis tubes, which are like the same profiles that MX11769 was shown earlier, up to the latest, greatest, auto-gated, filmless, L3. It's got a spec sheet. There's a whole gamut of prices that go along with tubes. People will buy them off eBay, kind of older stuff, maybe early Gen 3. They can snag them for a couple hundred dollars, maybe $600, $700. I've seen some that have blems and maybe aren't the best quality go for under $5. So if you're able to snag all that and put it all together, you could potentially put together a Gen 3 unit. Granted, it'll be pretty old technology, maybe not the best glass, maybe not the best housing, but you're looking at $1,000 to $1,200. Kind of the next step from that would be like buying a complete unit, as we kind of talked about. So my biggest seller as far as monoculars go is I do blem PVS-14s. So it's a complete mil-spec PVS-14 with optics. It's got all the mounts, everything you need to run it. And the tube has a small blemish in it, usually a black spot somewhere in the middle half of the image tube. This makes it so I can't sell it as a clean tube in a bino unit or put it in a clip-on. But there's still a market for them, and I can get the tubes a little bit cheaper. So a unit like that would run you around $2,300, all said and done, ready to go out the door. So for somebody who's really trying to save a lot of money, the build option looks a lot more appealing from the surface. And, a lot of people like to tinker with stuff. I love tinkering with stuff. I like buying my own parts and putting stuff together, whether it's, an AR-15 or a car or, night vision. It's kind of fun to do that sort of thing.
Is it something that you can complete the project at home, or are you needing to bring it to somewhere to like purge it with nitrogen or seal it together with a vacuum or anything like that?
Or do the soldering, connecting the leads?
It's most people would be able to put one together at home if they have basic hand tools. I have a lot of tools that I've either bought that were custom made for something, or I've made for doing particular jobs just because I'm doing them so frequently and I need to be repeatable and have the correct torques on everything. And you could do it without having those tools, because those tools, even the basic like PVS-14 build tool set, would probably run you around $150 to $200. That, unless you're planning on building a bunch of them, which very few people are, you know, you don't really recoup that money. So that's another factor into it. As far as doing like the nitrogen purge and the vacuum, I purge in everything I build before I ship it. It does help, especially if you're in a humid environment. You know, we get the summertime here and it's humid out. If you don't have a purge, you're going to start getting condensation on the inside of your night vision, and your image is going to look terrible. You're not going to be able to figure out why you can't see anything. Some people can get away with it. You know, if you're living in the Southwest where it's 90 degrees but no humidity all the time, you could probably get away with not purging it. And there's kind of homebrew ways you can purge them. You know, there's a couple different write-ups around the internet of using a duster can to do it, or, you know, using kind of common household items to purge something out. One of the things I actually do a lot of is people will, you know, buy the pieces and then, like, maybe not necessarily realize what they're getting into, or want it to be done the right way. You know, they think they know the right way, but they're not sure. So I have people send me stuff a lot to put it together, and, you know, it's pretty inexpensive. I charge like $100 to do a monocular, $200 to do a bino, and I do it all for the bino units. I collimate them, I purge them, I clean them. So the, you know, whoever's getting it back knows they're getting a unit that's put together well. I checked over everything, and they're not going to have something that just suddenly breaks, or they strip something out and they can't get it fixed. So that's kind of one of the things I try to offer to people that even want to tackle the homebrew method, because, you know, it can be a little overwhelming, especially when you're talking the price point these things are at. You know, if you're talking $1,500 worth of parts, it's kind of hard to take your screwdriver and just start going at it. So,
you know, that brings up a question for me, Ryan. So let's say that I'm looking at building my own, a blemished PVS-14, and, you know, whatever is, you know, commercially available and supported by a manufacturer. I would assume that in my build it kit, I don't have a warranty.
Right.
Most of my stuff has come from secondhand, eBay, used, or there's, you know, some non-traditional mechanism to get it to me.
Right.
And if I buy it from the manufacturer, I'm assuming that, well, he's going to put whatever warranty that they customarily associate with it, but I have recourse if it shows up and, you know, there's a thumbnail-sized, you know, empty space in the middle of my night vision image. I can send it back and somebody will take care of it.
Right.
What about that middle ground when you've got something that's blemished and, you know, I think we've all looked at blemish this or blemish that, and we're like, okay, where's the blemish? What right. exactly is wrong with this that it's half price? I can't see it, so heck yeah, I'm going to buy it. What do you have in terms of that middle ground there? So, is it supported? Is there a warranty?
Yeah, I offer all my units, blemished or not, I have a 2-year warranty on a minimum. Some of them have longer than that depending on the manufacturer, but all the blemish tubes I get are, in the manufacturing process, they actually get a black spot in them. Rather than, you know, destroying these tubes, because once it has it, you can't really go back and fix it and eliminate it. So they have these tubes available. They can't sell them to a military contract. They can't sell it to the civilian market as a clean tube. And quite frankly, like you were saying earlier, most of the times the blemishes, you know, you can see it, but it's not really noticeable. Once you start using it, it's like it's not doesn't catch your eye, it doesn't annoy you, it's not in the center of the image, so it's not where you're going to be using it the most. You know, it's usually off to a side or a corner where you're, you know, if you really focus on it and you're just like, you know, obsessed with the blemish. I know there's some people I've sold them to that are just like, you know, super OCD, and it's like they flip it down and they just look for it, and then it just annoys them. So like, I want to clean too.
Their operational environment is white walls and white walls only.
Exactly. But myself, I'm cheap. So if I can save $600 on a unit and there's a little black spot in it that I can't find half the time, I'm okay with that. So it's, I think it definitely opens up the doors to a lot of people who this would be outside of their realm of possibility. You know, they're not willing to drop that $3,000 to buy a Gen 3 unit. But, you know, if you knock 30% off of that, they're like, you know, I got a couple extra rifles that I haven't shot in forever.
Now, you know that's $900, right?
it is.
So let me ask you this. In terms of, we talk about these generational levels, can you do that for all levels of night vision? Or is that something, because of the industry, that you're really only capable of doing at some given level? So could you do a Gen 2 blemished?
Like you were saying,
a Gen 4 blemished?
The price of the Gen 1s and 2s out the door really don't leave as big of a gap between you putting something together versus just buying it straight off the shelf.
But if you're selling blemished that's manufactured, is there some correlation there, or is it, once again, it's the same issue?
It's I'm sure they probably have blemishes in their manufacturing process, but the tubes themselves are at such a lower price point, especially for like the Gen 1 stuff. I mean, the tubes are maybe $150 of the price. If they were to, I don't know honestly for sure, but I think they just kind of write those ones off.
Throw them away.
Like, I mean, you know, if you got the opportunity to buy a brand new Gen 1 night vision and it's $500, or you can get a blemished one for $450, you'll probably be a little bit more prone to spend the extra $50 and get the, you know, the complete one that there's nothing wrong with, not knowing what you're getting into.
So I the market is just, it translates into that whole blemished arena regardless of how you're going to get into it.
Right.
Now, above that point where it's a possibility to make it a viable offering, are there breaks when you become more and more sophisticated with the tubes? Or, I mean, is there a sweet spot, or is it just anything Gen 3 and above you get the same benefit from in terms of blemishes?
I honestly haven't seen many Gen 1 or Gen 2 blemished anything available, whether as tubes or as complete units.
Well, I'm not talking about that, but like we talked about Gen 3 in terms of that's where your sweet spot starts.
Sure.
At Gen 3, is there a distinguishing level when we get more
and more
complex?
So maybe some of the feature sets, like you're saying, auto-gating and having spec sheets and stuff like that, what are you getting if you pay for like a Gucci Gen 3 tube?
So like a blemished? Like the Gen 3 tubes I sell, they're I've got ITT and L3s. They're auto-gated. They're usually like Omni 6 or Omni 7 specs, which the current spec is 8. So they're very recent as far as high resolution, good low light capabilities, pretty low noise as far as in low light conditions. Not a lot of bloom on the image. So, you know, in a lot of cases, literally, you're looking at the difference, you know, $22.95 for a blemished PVS-14 kit, $28.95 for a unblemished, and other than that black spot, the tubes will have the exact same specs. So it's not like you're getting a blemish and oh, it's missing all these features. It doesn't have air conditioning and you know, the turbocharger under the hood. Like you're still getting everything else is comparable between them, minus you now have this black spot. There are different levels of tubes available, even for, I mean, if you wanted clean tubes and you didn't want any black spots, currently you can get everything from like a Omni 3 or 4, which should be a little bit lower resolution, not as good in low light. Generally, they aren't auto-gated, up to the 7 and 8s, which are the latest and greatest tubes that even the military is getting, and everything in between. So there's a lot of different levels of tube quality, both resolution and like low light performance wise, with different price points to go along with them. As far as like generations go, like Gen 1's kind of just Gen 1. Gen 2 has like two or three different distinct levels of performance. And then once you get up to Gen 3, it's like there's like 10 different levels of performance that are all distinct in their own way. So it's kind of deceiving to call Gen 3 all one big, because early Gen 3 is so unlike the latest generation Gen 3 that they're really not super comparable.
I guess one thing you mentioned is your military experience. You do maintenance and upgrades. Is it something that you need to do regular maintenance on these, or is it more of a like a repairing damage sort of process that you get involved in?
On the military side, we do maintenance every 6 months. So we check the collimation on all our binoculars. We're cleaning, we're purging everything. We're inspecting the whole unit, making sure there isn't any damage. And that happens every 6 months, regardless if it was used at all. In some environments, like when we were flying in Iraq, like we were having to do it more often because they're getting used a lot. They're out in a dusty environment. So we were cleaning and checking up on a lot more. A lot of people on the civilian side don't really do that. That doesn't necessarily mean it's a bad thing, but every once in a while I'll get units in that, you know, might be 4 or 5 years old and never really been checked up on, and, you know, something else is broke. So I'll go through them and, like, you know, replace the O-rings on the eyepiece and the objective and re-grease them and clean them and purge them and send it back, you know, and they'll just be amazed, like, this is a night and day difference from what I sent you. Like, is this even the same unit? So it's kind of like your car. You know, if you do a little bit of preventative maintenance, sure, it might cost you $50, $75 here and there, but over the lifespan of that item, it will work that much better. A lot of cases, I think it's worth it. Most of the people who are doing that sort of, you know, more of like a preventative maintenance schedule rather than fix this, it's broke, are law enforcement agencies, federal agencies, stuff like that, that are, you know, using this gear, and it's very important for them that they can pull this out and it's ready to go, and they don't have to be like, oh, somebody left the batteries in it for the last 3 months and now it won't turn on. So.
Right. You mentioned there's some sort of upgrade system that you do for law enforcement from time to time.
Yeah, so a lot of what I do, I'm kind of in a unique position in my business. A lot of the other night vision businesses out there are more just focused on the sales side of it. What I'm doing, I actually do, you know, the maintenance, and I do the builds and repairs and stuff. So that's kind of a pretty niche market within the industry. I do a lot for other companies as far as that goes. But a lot of what I like to do, and I've kind of been working a lot more towards recently, is a lot of these local law enforcement agencies, federal agencies, are getting gear either through grants, they're purchasing it themselves, or in a lot of cases they get it through what's called the 1033 program, which is kind of a way for the military to get rid of old equipment and make it available to these agencies to use on their own without having to incur the costs of buying thousands of dollars in night vision. Generally speaking, if the military is getting rid of especially stuff like night vision these days, it's in a very poor condition, sometimes unusable condition. So they'll get these night vision units, and it's like, well, we got them, but we can't use them, or we don't have the correct mounts, or we don't know how to put them on our helmets because we don't have helmet mounts. So I've been kind of working with a lot of law enforcement agencies to you know, say, hey, these are some options that are available to you. These are the mounts you need to make them work on your helmets. Or, hey, if you're not using those binoculars because you want to have binos, rather than spending $12,000 on brand new binos per unit, send me your PBS-14s you're not using, and for $2,000, I can build them into binos, so you can get six times the amount of units you would have gotten with the same amount of money. Or if you only wanted 10 units, you pay 1/6 of the price. And especially these days, you know, a lot of the federal and law enforcement agencies are kind of cracking down on the budgets, so it's becoming a lot more beneficial to people like that. But I do the same thing a lot with civilians, too. You know, people buy a PBS-14, and then down the road they buy another one, and then they, you know, go do a shoot house like you do, and they're like, you know what, I kind of want a bino.
Yeah.
But they're $7,500, $8,000. Like, I can't afford that. Like, well, you got two PBS-14s. They got good optics. You know, buy a housing, put them in it for $1,500, $2,000. You got a bino unit. You sell off the parts that were left over in the PBS-14 build, you might have another $1,200 wrapped up in it. So it's kind of one of the unique things I can offer that is kind of starting to catch people's eyes, especially as, you know, they're looking at budgets and stuff, that, you know, we can get a lot more bang for our buck reusing the stuff we have and fixing it rather than continually buying new equipment.
Awesome.
Hey, Ryan, I've got a question for you. In terms of the units themselves, you know, my understanding that the original Gen 1 stuff, it had a finite life. I mean, I guess it was the phosphor screen that would just basically burn out or fade out or become inert. What's the life look like on one of these? I mean, it seems to me that if you had to pay $8,000 for something that might be dead in 2 years, it would be a kind of a ridiculous expenditure. But how is it for a third-gen tube?
I haven't ever actually seen a good solid figure, but everything I've ever seen was 10,000-plus hours of use. So, I mean, if you were using it every night, all night, for the next 8 years, you almost might have to worry about it burning out. Quite frankly, at that point, you would have spent almost the same amount of money on AA batteries or CR123s as the unit cost. So it might be a non-issue. I can honestly say I don't know that I've ever seen but maybe two or three units that actually failed as far as weren't induced by some sort of user error. Probably 99% of what I see as far as broken units are they left them on outside, they shined an IR laser into the front of it, they stared at the sun for too long, you know, just stuff that's it's pretty preventable, but you know it happens. Some of them, like the PBS-14s, they'll try to mount them to their rifle, and they're pretty prone, especially the newer stuff is pretty prone to recoil damage. So, you know, you put it on a high recoil rifle, pull the trigger, and all of a sudden you see black spots everywhere. You just damage your phosphor screen and, you know, impact it on the micro cathodes. So your tube's pretty much done. But as far as, you know, people turning them on and then they just suddenly die, I've only seen probably two or three, to be completely honest. And they were covered under warranty. So realistically, it was a non-issue.
You know, I think one of the things that occurs to me in terms of just what all of this means is this question of at what point should you be satisfied at some generational level and what drives you in terms of need or missing function to the next level. You know, and I've seen Gen 1, and basically for a guy that's going to put it on a 22 or who's going to fart around with it, it's great because you haven't blown that big, you know, stash of cash for a toy, essentially. And frankly, I think there's some night vision toys that are as good as Gen 1 stuff. But when are you going to be compelled to make that leap to the next level? And, you know, obviously there's a sweet spot in terms of these that I think, you know, obviously the guy that wants to sell you an $8,000 unit isn't going to tell you the sweet spot that'll take a little commission out of his pocket.
Sure.
Where do you feel that sweet spot is?
So for most people, you know, whether it be the, I want to go in the backyard and shoot my 22, you know, the prepper type of people, whatever it may be, that, you know, kind of want it more as a contingency, but aren't willing to dump a lot of money, you know, investing in a good Gen 1 unit and buying the correct supporting gear, you know, buying a helmet mount, buying a good IR light, buying an IR laser. Like, you can put together, all said and done, a pretty nice usable package in all but the worst of conditions for well under $1,000. Kind of the next step up from there, it's as far as for like tactical use, I kind of generally just skip over Gen 2. The price point is close enough between the two that, you know, if you're really wanting to do shoot houses and, you know, doing SWAT team stuff or doing tactical shooting type of stuff, the Gen 3 is where you're going to want to be at. The Gen 2 is, however, good for people who are wanting to get into hunting. So like that Legionnaire clip-on, you can get clip-on systems similar to that with a Gen 2 tube for $1,700 to $1,800. You step that up to a Gen 3 tube, you're talking closer to $3,500, $4,000. So there's a pretty significant jump there. And if it's somebody that's hunting Texas or hunting, you know, somewhere down south, hunting hogs or, up, you know, upper Midwest, hunting coyotes, wherever it may be, and they have the ability to use IR light, buying a Gen 2 unit and a really good quality IR light is like half the price of buying a Gen 3 unit. And you'll get about the same performance of a Gen 2 unit with an IR light as you would out of a Gen 3. Some cases better depending on what the lighting conditions are doing. So I think the Gen 2 is a really good option for those who are like really serious, especially about like the predator hunting, the hog hunters, who aren't quite ready to take that leap into the $3,000 to $4,000 realm of night vision equipment. And then the Gen 3 are, you know, they're for the guys that are really serious about it. You know, they're the guys that are taking the shoot house training, doing the low light classes. The honestly, a lot of my business are people who are just really hardcore airsofters. I mean, they're serious about it, and they'll spend some big money on buying night vision equipment to go do airsoft. The guys who are law enforcement, federal agencies, a lot of my guys that are buying stuff are former military. So, you know, they've used the Gen 3, and they look through the Gen 1, and they look through the Gen 2, and it's like, well, you know, I'm used to the Gen 3. Like, I want that. I'm not going to settle for less. So they're willing to make the sacrifices to, you know, sell off a rifle or two that they don't use anymore or something like that to buy it. And but it's not for everybody. And I think there's definitely a price point and a capability at each one for the right type of person, for sure.
And we've covered a lot of things. I bet there's podcasts out there that just talk about night vision every week, and we just try to cram it into one episode.
Well, you know, we could do like the a last part time two we, or something.
Yeah, exactly.
The last time we did that, we got a lot of hate mail.
Well, we can. We've already got a couple pieces of feedback here that JD got from Facebook. Definitely, this is a huge topic that I expect a lot of people to have questions about, to have stuck with it the whole way and listened through. Thank you. And I'm sure there's going to be some questions, and we'll have Ryan weigh in on some of them. If there's a couple questions that pop up on Facebook, I'll message him, say, hey, hop over here and answer them. That's what's great about having all these different pages linked together and stuff. We can really kind of keep the conversation going. I'm just going to hop in to a couple pieces of feedback here. Seth on the page, he says, hey, could you talk about the clip-on style? He's running a Sightmark Ghost Hunter monocular with a clip-on mount on a 1.5 to 6 power scope. He was told that throwing it in front of the scope is going to throw the zero off. But when he does it behind the scope, the image quality is poor. He said he called Sightmark, and their rep didn't really have a good answer for him. I know we kind of covered this at the front, but I think the short answer is if you've got a good night vision scope behind it, you might be able to intensify okay enough.
Yep.
If it's in front of it and it's dedicated for it, then your zero shift is going to be minimal. But if you're trying to kind of cobble something together, whether it's with a 14 or with a lower cost night vision scope, you're going to have some zero shift. And if the mount to strap it onto that Picatinny isn't solid, who knows how repeatable it's going to be. You might have to re-zero every time.
And that might be something worth for him to you know, mount it in the front and, you know, go shoot it at somewhere close, 25 yards. And just see where it's hitting. And if it's something that, you know, it's an inch or two off and he takes it off and remounts it and it is repeatable, you know, that's something worth noting, because if it is repeatable, you know, you can make those adjustments if need be. If it's not repeatable, then you might want to look at a little bit different option of mounting it. But
yeah. Another question here from Mike. He says, it'd be great to see a range of night vision talked about, from the budget-minded guy to the guy who has the most toys wins type night vision. I myself would love a decent price piece that would allow me to snipe pests around my chicken coop at 75 yards or less. I think the whole head-mounted Gen 1, 2 plus illumination is a really good option. One thing that's cool about around the chicken coop is you've probably got power run out there, and you could get like some IR floods just mounted to the coop. So looking out with your night vision on, it's bright as day, and maybe you could throw some sort of laser onto your 22 or whatever you're popping those guys with, and you'd have the reach to kind of see what's going on out there without needing like a big monstrous like flashlight strapped to the side of your gun.
Yeah, that'd be a real good, and to be honest, especially like with the Gen 1 units, you don't even necessarily have to buy an IR laser. You could, you know, use a green, well, green doesn't work as well, but reds show up pretty well, especially through the Gen 1, and, you know, save you a little bit of money there as long as you don't mind having a dot out there. Depending on what the pest is, a lot of times they're not really bothered by it. So
maybe they'd be attracted to it.
Yeah, you're like a cat.
Hey, now. So, yeah, I mean, like Seth and Mike have done, they posted some comments asking for just some of our comments on their night vision applications. Go ahead and just keep posting those, and we'll keep up with you. We'll throw them in the next show to discuss, and probably get Ryan online to type back a couple things to you. I know he's got what we talked about today is just a fraction of his knowledge base and what he has learned over the years.
It sounds like you're just trying to butter him up for a discount.
Yeah, I don't know. That clip-on sounds really cool. I mean, you just leave the scope on your gun, clip something on the front. Do you
might have to demo it, right? Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Do they take recoil okay? Because there's a ton of Picatinny out on the front of my Scar Heavy.
They're rated up to 308. I will say, since you mentioned what type it is,
yeah,
Scar Heavies are very tough on optics in general.
I figured, yeah.
And I have shied away from shooting mine on a Scar.
Yeah.
I don't want to learn that expensive lesson too hard. But I've shot it on bigger rifles and in like my PBS 27, I shot it on my 50 BMG and it handles it. And it really depends on how the clip on is made, but they will handle a lot of recoil and are made to handle a lot of recoil. So that being said, the Scar,
like the Bolt 308s and stuff like that, it'd be perfect for.
Yeah. Pretty much any AR platform are phenomenal. All my coyote hunting, I use a little 5.56 AR, and I shoot that thing all the time. I've probably put 4,000 or 5,000 rounds through that a year, so it's my little. I do a lot of demo days here locally with the guys around me. Let them go out and shoot night vision. So I'm always out shooting that thing, but it takes a beating and hasn't had any problems. So.
Awesome. Hey, Reed, we've got a giveaway here. You want to tell everybody who won this week?
Sure. Looks like this week is Stephen Carter. And it being the middle of the month, Stephen, you have won a cleaning kit. So we want to remind everybody else who didn't win that you still have plenty of opportunities to win, because the fine folks at Otis Technology have sent over a mountain of rifle maintenance tools that over the course of the last however many weeks and months it's been, you've slowly whittled down to a molehill. But there still are plenty left, and we want to remind you to watch for the special posts on Facebook to get a chance to win some of the awesome products made by Otis Technology. So we'll give away a complete MSR cleaning kit in either 556 or 762 in the middle of each month up until Christmas. And when Christmas rolls around, we'll give away a complete Otis Technology cleaning system to one lucky listener. So during the alternating weeks, we'll be giving away the rest of what Otis provided us, which are a host of tools and cleaning supplies for the AR and the AR-10. So keep tuning in, keep signing up, and we may very well get to your name before it's all said and done.
Well, Ryan, I really appreciate you taking the time to kind of stand up to our questioning here. Definitely a lot of knowledge dropped. There's going to be kind of an overview in the show notes here, but it's not going to come close to capturing what we were able to discuss. Could you tell people again how to get a hold of you and the work that you're doing at Nightlong?
Yeah. Get a hold of me. I'm on. Our website is www.nightlongind.com. I'm also on Facebook as Nightlong Industries LLC. I've got Instagram and YouTube linked through the website as well. Do a little bit of everything, night vision and thermal sales, research, do some development work, and repairs, maintenance on them as well. So I'd be happy to answer any questions any your viewership might have about them, or they got a question about something they already have set up and are having problems with, I'd be happy to answer them as well.
Perfect. We really appreciate it. If you guys want to pass along your questions through us, you can reach us at feedback@ar15podcast.com. You can also leave us a recorded voicemail on the website using the SpeakPipe plugin. Remember to subscribe and listen to the show here for free, either on iTunes or over on Stitcher. Please leave us a review if you listen. You haven't done that yet. That'll help place us higher for kind of in the search results for other people looking for a show like this. Share your pictures with us over on Instagram at AR15podcast or just hashtag the same thing. Check us out on Periscope. Every once in a while, I'll boot that up when I'm hitting the range. And it's always interesting to see some of the foreign people come in and, and those crazy Americans and their guns. We are broadcasting live on Google+. When we broadcast, typically Monday or Wednesday nights, we'll post a link over on Facebook so you can watch us live. These video recordings end up on YouTube, where you can find us. Obviously, Facebook is a place where JD has helped us become that much more connected with you guys. So we love all the feedback that's been rolling in there. Check out some of the other great podcasts on the Firearms Radio Network. We are just one of many shows about all sorts of different things. So take a look if you haven't yet to see if there's another show that piques your interest. When you're shopping for AR parts, on Brownells, please visit our affiliate link by going to ar15podcast.com/parts. That'll let them know that you're one of our listeners, and they'll continue to help us out getting this broadcasted. For everything else, when you're visiting Amazon, you could do that by first going to our website, ar15podcast.com, and then clicking on the Amazon link. That'll benefit us as well. This bandwidth isn't cheap, and it'll help Jake pay some of the bills here. So, really appreciate it, guys. Any final words from the rest of you?
Before we let you go, I want to remind everybody that SHOT Show is beginning to gear up. We are beginning to get our preliminary emails, registration is going on. We're going to be planning our attendance this year, and likely extending all of you listeners every year. We want to hear from you. We want to know what you're interested in, what you'd like to hear more about, and how you would like us to focus our attentions while we're there, besides obviously being in some city. So, so with that, I guess any final thoughts for the rest of you guys? I'll take that as a resounding no.
Stay safe out there, guys, and have fun, especially if you can see in the dark.
Have a good one, guys.
This has been a production of the Firearms Radio Network. You can find more information at firearmsradio.tv.